This is a plastic specimen of a male pelvis. It shows the lateral aspect of the pelvis as well as a mid-sagittal section. To be oriented, posteriorly is the sacrum and the coccyx, and anteriorly, this is the region of the pubic bone, superior ramus of the pubis, inferior ramus of the pubis, and here, this is the obturator foramen. Of the structures that we can see in the pelvis, posteriorly, this is the rectum, and this is the urinary bladder. Below is the prostate. Now let's go into more details. Look at the sacrum and notice the sacral canal here. The sacral canal contains the caudate quina, and you can see that the subarachnoid space ends at the level of S2 segment. Below that, there is no subarachnoid space, and the sacral canal is occupied by the phylum terminale. In front of the sacrum, the vessel here in the midline is the median sacral artery. This is a branch of the abdominal aorta before its bifurcation. In front of the sacrum as well, this is the sigmoid colon, and then it gives rise to the rectum. The rectum, and this starts at the level of S3 vertebra. So this is the S3 segment where the rectum starts. Inside the rectum, you notice here one of the valves of Houston, rectal valves of Houston. Three of these valves are present. The rectum, as you can see here, is not straight. It is concave with the concavity of the sacrum. And here, the rectum passes through the pelvic diaphragm and gives rise to the anal canal. There is an angulation at the recto-anal junction. This is the anal canal here. The anal canal is surrounded by two sphincters, an internal anal sphincter and external anal sphincter, which is the voluntary sphincter. Between the coccyx and the anal canal, there is a ligament or a raphe, midline raphe, the anococcygeal ligament or the anococcygeal raphe. This is the meeting point of the two levator ani muscles. In front of the rectum is the prostate gland, and you can appreciate how the prostate gland can be felt through PR examination. The prostate gland has the size and shape of a chestnut and is related to the neck of the urinary bladder. Just above that is the seminal vesicles. This is one of the seminal vesicles, and here this is the vas or the ductus deferens. If we follow the vas, we can see that the vas starts in the testis. This is the testis here, and related to the posterolateral surface of the testis is the epididymis. It has a head, body, and tail, and the vas arises from the tail of the epididymis and ascends up. It constitutes one of the constituents of the spermatic cord. Of the other constituents that we can see here is the testicular artery and the testicular veins, the pampiniform plexus of veins that give rise to the testicular vein. Following the vas up, the vas continues onto the anterior abdominal wall, where it passes through the superficial inguinal ring and then the deep inguinal ring and gains access to the pelvis. And you can see here that the vas hooks over the ureter. In the region of the perineum, this is the site of the perineal body. The perineal body is a fibromuscular structure, consists of fibrous tissue to which a lot of muscle fibers are attached to. One of these muscle fibers is part of the external anal sphincter, the superficial transverse perineal muscle, and the bulbospongiosus muscle that covers the bulb of the penis. Now we have removed part of the specimen so that a pure mid-sagittal section is evident here. Again, this is the rectum. In front of the rectum is the prostate gland. Note that the prostate gland has a base that is related to the neck of the bladder and has an apex. The urethra that arises from the urinary bladder passes through the base of the prostate, traverses the prostate as the prostatic urethra, and leaves at the apex, where it enters into the urogenital diaphragm. This is the urogenital diaphragm. The urogenital diaphragm is a fibromuscular diaphragm. It consists of two layers of fibrous tissue, the superior fascia and the inferior fascia of the urogenital diaphragm. The inferior fascia of the urogenital diaphragm is also called the perineal membrane. In between these two layers of fascia, the muscle fiber here constitutes the sphincter urethral muscle that surrounds the urethra and provides a voluntary sphincter to the urethra. Opening into the urethra, into the prostatic urethra here, is the ejaculatory duct. Between the ejaculatory duct and the prostatic urethra, this part of the prostate is called the median lobe of the prostate, or the middle lobe of the prostate. This is the part of the prostate that is mainly affected by benign prostatic hyperplasia. And when it enlarges, it pushes itself up into the region of the trigone of the bladder and causes its elevation, producing what is called the uvula vesicae. The prostate is surrounded by fascia, and this fascia contains a lot of blood vessels constituting the prostatic venous plexus. Below the urogenital diaphragm is the root of the penis. Here you can see this is the bulb, and the bulb gives rise to the corpus spongiosum. If we follow the corpus spongiosum is going to be dilated distally and forms the glands of the penis. The glands overhangs or overlaps the other cylinder of the penis located on the dorsum of the penis, and this is the corpus cavernosum. The corpus cavernosum starts as a crust in the superficial perineal pouch, and in the body it will form the corpus cavernosum. The urethra that started at the internal urethral meatus passes through the prostate as the prostatic urethra, traverses the urogenital diaphragm as the membranous urethra, and then it passes into the bulb of the penis as the bulbar urethra, continues into the corpus spongiosum as the spongy urethra, and is dilated at its distal end to form a fossa, which is called the navicular fossa, that leads into the external urethral meatus. Notice that the glands of the penis here is covered by a piece of skin that is called the prepuce or the foreskin. This piece of skin is removed during circumcision. The body of the penis is hanging from the pubic symphysis or the region of the pubic symphysis by a suspensory ligament of the penis. And you can see here that superficial to the fascia here, there is the dorsal vein of the penis, the superficial dorsal vein of the penis, and this is the deep dorsal vein of the penis. The deep dorsal vein of the penis drains through a deficiency in the urogenital diaphragm anteriorly. It drains into the prostatic venous plexus. The superficial dorsal vein of the penis drains into the great saphenous vein. Also, you can see here a section in the scrotum where you can see the testis here. This is the testis, and this is the region of the epididymis. Both the testis and epididymis are related to the tunica vaginalis. Further coverings of the testis are not very clear in this specimen. Between the anal canal and the root of the penis, you can see this is the fibromuscular body, the perineal body. The urinary bladder is a muscular sac. It has a thick muscular wall, detrusor muscle fibers that are not arranged in layers. They have different directions because to allow for mass contraction of the bladder rather than peristalsis. The inside of the bladder, the inside of the empty bladder, as you can see here, is drawn into folds, except in the region of the trigone where it is smooth, because the mucosa is firmly attached to the underlying muscle coat. This is the region of the base of the bladder. The base of the bladder faces the apex of the bladder. Arising from the apex of the bladder is a fold, fibrous fold, which constitutes the median umbilical ligament. Behind the bladder is a peritoneal pouch, which is called the rectovesical pouch, where the peritoneum is reflected from the rectum onto the posterior surface of the bladder in the male, and then onto the superior surface of the bladder. As it is reflected here, it covers the seminal vesicles as well. The posterior surface of the bladder below the rectovesical pouch is related to the seminal vesicles. So here is the posterior surface of the bladder, and these are the seminal vesicles here. And then further below is the prostate. The prostate gland is separated from the rectum by a membrane or a septum. This is the region of the septum, rectovesical fascia or rectovesical septum, or the fascia of Guillain-Barré. This fascia provides a barrier for the spread of tumor from the rectum to the prostate or from the prostate to the rectum. And it is more firmly attached to the rectum than to the prostate. Between the anterior aspect of the urinary bladder and the pubic symphysis, this is the retropubic space, the extraperitoneal space, retropubic space, or the cave of Ridzius. Thickenings of fascia can be found here, thickening of pelvic fascia that constitute the puboprostatic ligament. If we look at the specimen from above, you can see that this is the aorta and here is the inferior vena cava. The aorta bifurcates at the level of L4 into two common iliac arteries. Here, this is the external iliac artery accompanied by the external iliac vein. At the site of bifurcation of the common iliac artery, the vessels are crossed by the ureter. The ureter comes from the abdomen down, and it is here crossing the site of bifurcation of the common iliac vessels to enter into the pelvis. Before it enters into the wall of the bladder, the ureter itself is being crossed by the vas, or the ductus deferens. The ductus deferens, as you can see here, it comes from the deep inguinal ring and crosses over the lateral wall of the pelvis, then crosses over the ureter, hooks on the ureter before it passes into the back of the urinary bladder. These vessels here, which we can see, are the gonadal vessels. Of course, this is a male specimen, so we can say that these are testicular vessels, the testicular artery and the testicular veins, which are a continuation of the pampiniform plexus and the testis. Both of these vessels are directed into the deep inguinal ring accompanying the vas, where all of them, they will constitute part of the constituents of the spermatic cord.